Well, thank you. Thank you for that ministry, praise team, worship team. What do you guys want to go by?
People who sing.
Well, you're more than singing. You're praising the Lord, and we're really blessed by the abilities the Lord has given you to bless us, and as we all lift our voices together and praising the Lord. What a ministry in itself. Right? It just blesses the soul. Good. Welcome. And for you, for those of you who may be here visiting, welcome as well. We're glad to have you with us. You know, on your journey to the church this morning, there's one thing that you didn't have to worry about. With all of the worries that we have, there's one thing that you didn't have to worry about.
Snow.
Yeah. Sounded like a true Canadian from the Great White North. We didn't have to worry about snow. That reminds me of the story that was told some years ago of a pastor who found the roads blocked one Sunday morning and was forced to skate on the river to get to the church. So he did that. When he arrived, the elders of the church were horrified that their preacher had skated on the Lord's Day. After the service, they held a meeting where the pastor explained that it was either skate to the church or not go at all. Finally, one elder asked, "Did you enjoy it?" When the preacher answered, "No," the board decided it was all right. Oh dear. Nothing can choke the heart and soul out of walking with God like legalism. There's a story of a Christian of a bygone era who said, "I am earnest, I desire about forsaking the world and following Christ, but I'm puzzled about worldly things. What is it I must forsake?" A young man asks, "Colored clothes, for one thing. Get rid of everything in your wardrobe that is not white. Stop sleeping on a soft pillow. Sell your musical instruments and don't eat any more white bread." "You cannot, if you are sincere about obeying Christ, take warm baths or shave your head. To shave is to lie against Him who created us, to attempt to improve upon His work." Elizabeth Elliot, whose husband was Jim Elliot, who was martyred for his faith, he was the one who made this statement that we quote today: "He is no fool to give up what he cannot keep in order to gain what he cannot lose." Well, Elizabeth Elliot comments on the above statement and dialogue. Does this answer sound absurd? It is the answer given to the most celebrated Christian schools of the second century. You kind of wonder, what things are we imposing upon God's people today that aren't from the Word of God at all? You see, the churches at Galatia had fallen prey to a form of legalism by adding law to grace, or works to grace. There were those false believers who infiltrated their ranks in the church with the purpose of bringing the believers back into bondage to enslave them to the Mosaic laws and ceremonies. In contrast to the great two commands that Jesus gave, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Well, the Pharisees had developed a system of 613 laws. 365 negative commands and 248 positive ones. By the time Christ came in, it had produced a heartless, cold, arrogant brand of righteousness. So you can just imagine what it was like when the church was formed in Acts chapter 2, and it was just exploding, and people were coming to know the Lord as their personal Savior and have a real relationship with a living God. That did not stop the self-righteous from imposing their harsh religiosity upon people. But there was a price, and there was a cost. So we're going to consider Galatians chapter 2. You see, in Galatians chapter 2, Paul is going to address legalism head on and present a strong argument why it must be resisted. So if you have your Bibles, would you turn with me to Galatians chapter 2? This chapter can be broken down and have three subtitles to the main text of legalism being addressed head on. It begins with a private meeting in Jerusalem, the first 10 verses, and then it continues with a public beating. A public beating at Antioch. And what I mean by public beating is a verbal beating, a beat down, so to speak. For the next few verses, from 11 through 17, and then the last couple of verses of this chapter is really about a personal meaning for living. As Paul states that most familiar passage of Scripture, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I am. So we'll continue these issues in greater detail now. You see, Paul, as we think of what Paul was doing here, he goes, and we discussed in Galatians chapter 1, he was concerned about the Galatian believers. He was perplexed and astonished by how quickly they had deserted the one who called them to live in the grace of Christ. They began a life of faith, a new life in Christ, but they soon and quickly deserted that life because they sought to all of a sudden live in a manner that they were trying to be justified or live by the works of the law. And you can't do that. You've got to continue to live by faith as a Christian and not by the works of the law. So in chapter 2, Paul is going to journey to Jerusalem, beginning at verse 1 of chapter 2 of Galatians. Then after 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem. This may be 14 years after Paul's conversion or from his previous journey. This time with Barnabas, I took Titus along and I went in response to a revelation. So why did he go to Jerusalem? It was a response to a revelation that Paul went there. It was not as if Paul was being called on the carpet by the apostles, and he had to kind of explain himself because Paul was preaching to those dirty Gentiles. It was by a revelation. What visit is this that Paul is stating here? Where is it recorded? We're not sure. There's at least five times in the book of Acts that Paul visited Jerusalem. There's, of course, the Acts chapter 15 and that important meeting recorded there that we're more familiar with. And yet there's a less significant meeting or statement in Acts chapter 11 where Paul made a visit to Jerusalem based upon the prophecy of Agabus, who said that there was going to be a famine throughout the world, and that Paul and Barnabas left for Judea with a gift for the believers there. So it could have been that visit, because in verse 10 of chapter 2, it says, at the conclusion of this first point, the private meeting, all they asked was that we should continue to remember the poor, the very thing I had been eager to do all along. So that could have been the reason for them going. Originally was to bring a gift to the saints in Jerusalem. So Paul is on a journey with Barnabas, and who else? Titus. Is that important? Martin Luther suggests this. To show that God does not show favoritism, Paul brought Titus along just as a test. He was testing the apostles there in Jerusalem to see how they would respond to Titus, who was a Greek. He was a Gentile. You see, Paul didn't know all that much about these apostles. He hadn't met them that often in Jerusalem. So Paul was wondering where they're coming from, because there were those who were questioning the authenticity of Paul's message and his apostleship. So Paul presented himself as an apostle, as it says in the first verse of Galatians chapter 1. Paul, an apostle, sent not from men nor by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father. So there were some who were questioning Paul's authority. Who's he speaking for? And maybe they were putting on a pedestal the apostles in Jerusalem. You know, Peter, James, John, and the like. So here Paul is, Paul is going to have a private meeting with the apostles here in Jerusalem. He wants to understand what they think of his purpose in preaching the gospel to the Gentiles. Because up to this point, it's primarily to the Jews in Jerusalem. And then it's spread out to Samaria, the gospel message. And now it's starting to spread out to the outer regions of the world, so to speak. How are they going to respond to Titus? Well, number one is they did not state that he had to be circumcised. So that was a good start. Because that's what the Judaizers were doing, the false believers. They were saying, that's fine, you can be saved by trusting in Jesus, but you still have to live by the laws of Moses, and primarily circumcision. So we see that I went in response to a revelation in verse 2 of chapter 2. In Galatians, and meeting privately with those esteemed leaders. Look how Paul describes those, the apostles in Jerusalem. He refers to them as those esteemed leaders in verse 2. In verse 9, esteemed leaders. Look at verse 4. Those who were held in high esteem, whatever they were makes no difference to me. Paul's not trying to use derogatory terms to describe them, even though it may appear that way. But you see, let's make one thing clear, he's saying. What is first and foremost is the gospel. Mm-hmm. That is primary. Not who and what somebody is, because God shows no favoritism. And may we be reminded of that. Paul respects these individuals, but in their place, the gospel and the grace of God and the message of the gospel comes first. That is of prime importance. We are going to learn in this chapter as well, and it was stated last week, that if we are trying to please people, we cannot be servants of Christ. Paul said that in chapter 1 and verse 10. You see, Paul is living that out here. I am trying to please Christ, is Paul's desire. First and foremost is the gospel message. Now these apostles, as significant as important as they are not as important as the gospel and the truth of that message. So Paul and the apostles, the other apostles at Jerusalem, it says that they had a meeting, a secret meeting. It was a closed meeting. One more thing about this is we notice that Paul says, I wanted to, when he was visiting the saints in Jerusalem, he says, I wanted to be sure I was not running and had not been running my race in vain. It's not as if Paul's wondering, I wonder if what I'm doing is the truth. As if he's questioning his own purpose and plan. Because he already said he was called to be an apostle from God. The gospel message that he was given was from God. So he's not here looking for their approval, but he's hoping that in his making this journey to Jerusalem and having this meeting, that there will be an amicable resolution and conclusion, that it will not put the church into issues and struggles that would cause further damage and hurt. In that sense, he doesn't want it to be in vain, a waste of time. But Paul's not concerned that they're not going to accept him, that Paul's message perhaps is wrong. So Paul has this private meeting with the believers, with the apostles, and what is the conclusions they come to. May we also stress the point, you see, in this private meeting that Paul had with these apostles, the point is well made, and Barnes makes this in his Barnes Notes on the Bible, the point is well made that when a difficulty is to be settled, involving great principles and embracing a great many points, it is better to seek an opportunity of private explanation than to submit to a general multitude or to a public debate. It wasn't as if they were going to make this a public issue. This was an in-house issue that had to be resolved. So Paul goes about it that way. As it says there, I went in response to revelation and meeting privately with those esteemed as leaders in verse 2. So Paul is not suggesting or seeking their approval, but he does want to see where they stand. And what is the result of this meeting? They were all positive. Look at the conclusion of the matter in verse 9, if we can jump ahead just a little bit. Or in verse 8, for God who, or let's start at verse 7, on the contrary, once the explanation was given, and the issue was dealt with, how did the apostles respond in verse 7? On the contrary, they recognized that I had been entrusted with the task of preaching the gospel to the uncircumcised, just as Peter had been to the circumcised. For God, who was at work in Peter as an apostle to the circumcised, to the Jews, was also at work in me as an apostle to the Gentiles. James, Cephas, and John, those esteemed as pillars, gave me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship when they recognized the grace given to me. They agreed that we should go to the Gentiles and they to the circumcised. All they asked was that we should continue to remember the poor, the very thing that we had been eager to do all along. So if they did bring that love offering to the poor in Jerusalem, they were reminded to continue that. Isn't it interesting when there is a resolution and a conclusion, an amicable one at that, that there's power there. And there's power in unity of the believers that pushes us and thrusts us forward to minister to those outside. And that's always the purpose of the gospel. Whether it's ministering to people's physical needs or people's spiritual needs. When there's unity, we're reaching out. When there's disunity, we're too concerned and looking at one another and putting out fires and fighting one another that we cannot reach out effectively for the gospel and for the Lord and for ministering to the needs of others. So we see in this private meeting, it was worthwhile. It was beneficial. Unfortunately, it doesn't end with a private meeting. At a later date, we're not when it occurred, other than what it says here as we continue at verse 11 of chapter 2, but there was a public beating. There was a beat down at Antioch. And what do I mean by that? Well, let's look. When Cephas, that's Peter, came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he stood condemned. There was no right hand of fellowship here. There was a face to face. Tight to tight. Oh yeah. It was a beatdown. For before certain men came from James, this explains the reason why Paul confronted Peter to his face. Before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. Peter knew full well that the Gentiles were equal heirs of salvation. He had already received. We just got to look at Acts chapter 10 and verse 34, where Peter said, realized that God does not show favoritism. Even though Peter knew all this, Peter was just at this meeting already mentioned earlier in the chapter. When he went to Antioch, Peter enjoyed fellowship with the Gentiles and eating with them. But when the disciples of James came along up from Jerusalem, Peter became afraid. Remember? If you are going to be a man pleaser, you cannot be a servant of Christ. Why Peter was withdrawing when he saw the Jewish believers coming from Jerusalem, Peter became afraid of them. He wanted to please them, and they were more important than these disciples from Antioch who were Gentiles. And therefore he tried to withdraw himself. Very subtly is what's suggested in the meaning there of the word. So Peter was confronted publicly because of this. And by withdrawing from the Gentile believers, Peter was displaying public hypocrisy. That's why it wasn't a private meeting. That Paul didn't come along and say, Peter's, I want to talk to you about something. Peter was a recognized leader. What Peter was doing was recognized by those around what he was doing. Peter may have thought that he was getting away with it, or thinking that nobody was recognizing what he was doing. However, what does it say here? That other Jews joined him in the hypocrisy. So that by their hypocrisy, don't say it, but even Barnabas was led astray. Barnabas, the son of encouragement, started to act as Peter was. So that's why Paul needed to confront Peter publicly. It was a public sin. And not only was it a public sin by anyone, it was a public sin by one of the so-called pillars of the church, one of the apostles. Paul was concerned about what kind of gospel message was being preached by that kind of behavior. Things to ponder. Hypocrisy can be subtle, moving away from grace and freedom. And that can happen in our own life. We need, if we want a grace awakening, and that's really the title of a series of messages in the book of Galatians, is a grace awakening. We have to be careful about hypocrisy, about practicing one thing publicly and another thing privately. If you are a Christian also, your life is sending forth a louder message of influence than your words. You see, they weren't listening to Peter's words. They were looking at his life. And they were seeing an individual who was, because of the fear of man, was withdrawing from the Gentile believers, but he was practicing hypocrisy. Peter, who preached that we were all united in Christ, was not practicing that in his own life. Even though Peter and Barnabas were great men of God, they were still fallible. They were men at their best. So let's not be men pleasers, is another easy lesson to learn. Let me conclude this section with three summary principles. Why must legalism be resisted? Number one, legalism must be resisted because of what it does to the Word of God. Look at twice in verse 5 of chapter 2, we did not give in to them for a moment. Those who wanted to attach works to grace. He says, so that the truth of the gospel might be preserved. The truth of the gospel is what we hold up, not ourselves, but Christ. Look at verse 14. When I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, then they were confronted. It's the truth of the gospel that is of prime importance, that we protect. We go out of our way to know it and to preach it and to practice it by God's grace. Paul says it clearly in Ephesians chapter 2, doesn't he? For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. Legalism must be resisted, number two, because of what it does to us. What does it do, what does it do to me personally when I start to practice this? Howard Hendricks, maybe you've read his books, I've read a couple of them, has remarked that he grew up in a legalistic home where the use of fingernail polish was enough to condemn one to hell. He said, I repudiated legalism intellectually and theologically in 1946. But in 1982, I was still wrestling with it emotionally. You see, we need to be recognized what it does to us. What it does to me personally when I start to play this game of dotting my I's and crossing my T's. You see, it's a natural desire for the flesh to do that. To know, to live in the realm of my comfort zone. To practice my religion. To know how to live. To know what to say according to a self-righteousness. But I'm no longer living under grace. There's no grace awakening in my life when I'm living like that. Legalism must be resisted finally because of what it does to others. We already considered that Barnabas and many others were also influenced by the hypocrisy of another. We need to be reminded of what it does to others. Paul is going to give us principles for living under grace in a few moments. We'll consider that. As people under grace, we're not to make non-biblical requirements of others. Non-biblical. This means that we cannot make areas of lifestyle that are not spelled out in Scripture requirements for others in order that they may be considered good Christians. And finally, we're going to consider, and there's more to be considered in this passage of when Paul confronts Peter. But look at verse 17. But if seeking to be justified in Christ, we Jews find ourselves also among the sinners, doesn't that mean that Christ promotes sin? Absolutely not. Why would you want to begin a life by faith and then resort back to the law? Because the law just condemns you anyways. So why would you want to do that? That means that Christ promotes sin? Absolutely not. If I rebuild what I destroyed, then I really would be a lawbreaker. For through the law I died to the law, so that I might live for God. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God. For if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. That's it. That says it all right there. There is only one way to be freed from legalism, both positionally and practically. There is a time when if somebody says, you're a dead Christian, you know what? You can say, that's right, I am. Praise God. I'm crucified with Christ. That's a good way to recognize. We should be known as a dead church in a positive way. We're crucified with Christ. We're crucified with Christ. You see, Paul is now giving his personal meaning to what the crucifixion means to him. When we consider the Lord's table set before us, we consider what Christ has done for us, and we've received the forgiveness of sins, that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. And we know the bread represents his body, and the fruit of the vine represents his blood. But you see, it's not just about knowing that we're forgiven in the past, and Christ died 2,000 years ago. But we're also thinking about living today, and that crucifixion means something to me today. Christ died to the law. Though he was sinless, I identify with Christ who died to the law. And I'm dead to the law. The law has no power over me because I'm in Christ. And the life that I now live, I live by our responsibility, by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. You see, that's how we identify ourselves with Christ, is we recognize that the paradox is because of his death, I can live. Not simply about being forgiven, but living today. Living today for Christ in my life. F.V. Mayer put it this way. This is Paul's confession of the power of the cross in his life today. It stood between him and the past. His self-life was nailed there, and his new life was no longer derived from vain efforts to keep the law, but from the indwelling and overflowing of the life of Christ. We do not only preach Christ crucified forgiveness, we preach Christ crucified for living. Does God really love us? I say, look to the crucified Jesus. By every thorn that punctured his brow, by every mark of the back lacerating scourge, by every hair of his beard plucked from his cheeks by cruel fingers, by every bruise which heavy fists made upon his head, God said, I love you. By all the spit that landed on his face, by every drop of sinless blood that fell to the ground, by every breath of pain which Jesus drew upon the cross, by every beat of his loving heart, God said, I love you. And if Christ loved me enough to give himself for me, then he loves me enough to live out his life in me. So as we think of the Lord's table and the crucified Savior, don't just reminisce about the past and remember what Christ has done for you in the past. Remember the death of Christ and what it does for you today. You're no longer under the penalty of sin. But may you live in the power of Christ Jesus. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we give thanks to you for your grace and mercy. And there's so much more that could have been said in this passage of Scripture. But yet, Lord, I pray that what has been said, what we've considered this morning, may have resulted in a work that you're doing in each one's life that causes us to look to Christ. The finished work of the cross, the power of the cross. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Not only the past and the present, but the future. Christ is all sufficient. May we learn to live by faith. As we're reminded, the just shall live by faith. Thank you for each one here. As we continue now, this morning, in partaking of your table, may we reflect upon Christ and him alone. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.